go, y'all. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless God's holy name. Shall we stand now and get ready to worship the mighty good God?
Come into this house to gather in his name and worship him. Master, we have come into this house and gathered in your name to worship you. For you are the eternal God. Master, we come before you right now acknowledging and confessing, Lord, that we are your children. Saved by your grace and your mercy, Lord. Acknowledging, Lord, that once again you kept us on this side last night as we lay in the image of death. For that we say thank you, thank you, thank you. Unworthy as we are, but we come before you, Lord, because you said we can come boldly in the name of Jesus. Confessing, Lord, that we have failed you by thought, word, and deed. Lord, we realize we haven't done all of the things you asked us to do. The truth be known, Master, if we look at the record carefully, Lord, we have failed you, Lord, because we didn't offer a kind word yesterday. We didn't offer a helping hand, Lord. We had impure thoughts, Father. We recognize, Lord, that we are sinners saved by your grace and your mercy. But, Lord, we throw ourselves upon your grace and mercy because, Lord, we realize you have always dealt with us by your grace and your mercy. Lord, it would be within your right, Lord, to judge us. But, Lord, we thank you for sending Jesus so that we might have another opportunity in the land of the living. Master, we've come to worship you this morning in spirit and in truth. Lord, we ask that you will remove anything from us that would prevent us from worshiping you this morning the way you are fit to be worshiped. Have your way, Lord. Holy Spirit, come down and go. We're all done with you, Lord. And trust
Sometimes I get deep.
Right now, Lord.
John chapter 15, verses 1 through 2. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser.
Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit.
Already you are clean because of the word that I have spoken to you.
Abide in me, and I in you.
Thank you.
just sort of take our time addressing this. One, we want to continue praying for the victims of all the natural disasters that have been called into our country.
Yes.
In the Caribbean, from the Virgin Islands to Puerto Rico, to Mexico, the people of Barbuda, Dominica, and St. Martin and St. Barth, Virgin Islands, Dominican Republic, Haiti, and Turkey, and Queso's, and the Bahamas, and Cuba. It's tough when you face two category fires, and they destroy nearly all that you have. We've asked the church to support through the giving, and as of this date, we've raised a total of $2,973. Amen. Which we will forward that which we've collected to the Fifth Episcopal Office to support those that have been affected by the floods, both here as well as Sierra Leone. Thank you so much for your kindness. We are just in the midst of organizing a longer-term response, particularly to our extended family in the Virgin Islands. And we're not sure exactly what that might be, but we're looking at potentially having a team of builders who would help rebuild the home, perhaps in the springtime. As part of a community effort, we want to organize an effort for the entire Ventura County to raise resources so that we can send appropriate help to the appropriate areas to help people regain their lives. What we can do right now is what we're doing in terms of sending relief aid, but at some point in time there will be the need for some sustained rebuilding. And this has happened before in terms of having communities workers and persons to go and add a helping hand. And I'd like for our church to be one of those bright lights that does the same, along with asking our brothers and sisters in Ventura County to help in that regard. If any of you are moved or interested in helping us do the planning at this point, please contact my office. Like I said, this is not a rush thing. This is just going to take time for us to do that. But in the meantime, can we just take a moment just to remember our sisters and brothers, whether they are still digging out of the rubble of Mexico or the rubble in the various places where storms have come and gone. God, we can't predict where nature goes. All we can do is to respond when nature moves. When we lift up just in our own spirit, our sisters and brothers who have to deal with mudslides in Sierra Leone, Bangladesh, and in Mumbai. Our sisters and brothers who have to dig out of rubble in Mexico. Our sisters and brothers who are in the dark right now without running water and electricity. Caribbean. God, it's hard to imagine being where they are, but we know you're there. And we just ask your spirit just to touch not only those who have the courage to stand where they are, but those who have the ability to extend help, and that the help would come appropriately and timely. And then God, where we can't help, we ask that you would just give us a spirit of generosity and caring so that we can
touch lives in whatever way we can. We know that you're God of the universe. You're also God of love. Use us as an instrument of your love and your peace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Are there visitors in the house this morning? Anyone who is here for the first time or who haven't seen in a long time? If that's you, would you just raise your hand and stand? Give God praise anyway. And give a reminder that we have an affirmative responsibility to grab the hand of somebody and bring them to worship with us. Amen? You know, we can't self-congratulate ourselves for somebody that we didn't bring. So let's do that. Let's do that. We're called to go to the highways and byways and to compel men and women to come to Christ. In our bulletin, we list, as we do each Sunday, those persons who have requested prayer, irrespective of their circumstances. Some are at home, some are just need our prayer, some are in care institutions. Whatever the circumstance, we want to just remember them, and we ask that you, in your own praying time, in your own personal time, in your own praying closet, would call out their names and remember them. Last week at this time, we were lifting up the name of Brother Teddy Metatheria. And he's here today. Amen. We're also glad to see the Duffs here with us today, Sister Maxie and Brother. As we shared last week, Al's brother had passed and he had gone to the services there, and we're glad they're back. Dr. Ivan Jeffries, who had to leave this week, is it brother? Yeah, your aunt that had passed in Nashville?
In
Norfolk, Virginia, yes, right. And so we want to pray for her as she goes and travels to the East Coast to bury her aunt. Dr. Duncan is not with us today. In fact, he jumped on a plane last night to go to Minnesota. But that was after he had done marvelous work yesterday, along with our Men's Day Committee, and putting together that men's health forum. And that was a tremendous program. Let's give God praise. It was an excellent program. The information shared was outstanding. The attendance was great. And we also were joined by the nursing students from Cal State, Channel Islands, who joining us in our own community outreach. They did some blood pressures yesterday for the men that were in attendance, and several brothers had to be reminded that blood pressure is a serious issue, amen? And those of you that have prescriptions for your high blood pressure, it's not to be forgotten. You're to take it, and you're to follow, and you're to also monitor your blood pressure. And we're going to be following up on that because it's important that we remain healthy as a congregation and as a community and as the children of God. But that was just a great program yesterday, and it won't end until this afternoon. Amen. Do we have an announcement this afternoon? Okay, I'll carry it. Amen. Brother Wallace? Amen.
Good morning, Bethel.
Good morning.
This afternoon, the early part, the church service starts at 4 p.m. Normally, we have to bribe people to return in the afternoon, and we are continuing that tradition by serving you a meal around 2:30. So if you will come and partake of food, and then we ask you to stay and not go to sleep, and partake of the spiritual food that you will receive. And you might, you just might have the opportunity to hear this male chorus again.
Amen.
You'll also have the opportunity to hear one of our own,
yes, sir,
who grew up here at Bethel.
Amen.
I always remind Reverend Clark that I knew him when he was an usher. And he has grown into a wonderful ministry.
Yes, sir.
And he's coming back this afternoon to bring the word. So I encourage you to follow up on what the pastor has already said, to any stranger that you see between now and 4 p.m., invite that stranger to be a part of what we're going to do this afternoon. We thank you and God bless you.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Good morning. I just want to remind each and every one of you that on the 8th of October is our Pastor Appreciation Day. Let's give it up. Make sure that each and every one of you are there and that you invite your family to participate. And I'm asking for all the leaders of the different departments to please meet with me after church today just for just a brief moment so that we can just talk about what part of the program that they can be a part of. And also, I want to remind you that the 2nd of October is Pastor's birthday. So next Sunday, you turn 21 again. So we're just asking all of us to get together and act accordingly. Thank you so much and happy birthday.
On the Pastor's Appreciation Sunday, Bethel Memorial AM Church of San Diego is going to be traveling all the way from San Diego to come up here and worship with us.
Amen.
Reverend Harvey Vaughn III is their pastor. They've already chartered a bus and they're going to be bringing their choir. I think it's going to be their men's choir. But we want to receive them warmly and just have a good time in the Lord.
Amen.
Tomorrow night, the stewardship and finance committee meeting that we have to reschedule will happen. I'm asking for all those that are part of the stewardship and finance committee to please note that and please be in attendance. We have some important issues to address. Now, in the narthex, you will find a new handout. There's several handouts out there on the table. One, there's information about those that may have found their personal information caught up in the Equifax hack. Amen. Only 143 million names are in that. And there's a good chance that at least half the people here that have credit files.
Father, you've been one of those hacks. Now what do you do? You just sit there as a victim, or are there some affirmative things you can do? Based on the encouragement that I got from Brother Crip and some information that we have, there's information about what you can do about that. We all have rights with regard to this. I've already checked, and my stuff, they got my study too. You know, and so they're picking on pastors and everybody else. If they can get me, they can get you. In terms of what you can do, that handout is out there. Secondly, you'll find a handout having to do with a new ministry that we have called Bethel Staying Connected Ministry. And it's related to our college, military, family members that are away from the church and away from this community, and our relatives who are behind the walls, whether it's county, penal institutions, state or federal. And there's a form that you can fill out in which you indicate who they are and their information. Because we as a church are going to be writing to those who are away. That's our staying connected. We want to let them know that we are not forgetting them. Those that are in college, we want to encourage them. And our college students that are away, we will be sending them a little goodie bag every now and then. So we need to know who they are and where they are so we can communicate with them. Those that are in the military, we want to continue thanking them for their service and let them know that we're praying for them. And those that happen to be behind the walls, we want them to know that we're not forgetting them. Amen?
Amen.
So this is a new ministry. It's called Staying Connected. When you pick up the form, you'll find all the information you need to turn into the office so that we can begin this ministry, which will begin in October of this year. I promise myself I wouldn't talk about number 45. If my knees weren't so bad, I'd take a knee right now. Enough said on that. Don't have to say much more. But anyway, we have a glorious week coming up as we finish our conference year. We have just a total of 5 more weeks of activity. Including in that is our fall revival. And if you would just turn to that page, because we haven't made much mention of it, just to let you know that it's happening. And that's on one of our wonderful color bulletin that says Fall Revival. The 3 preachers that we have coming, Reverend T.C. Johnson, Reverend Lonnie McCollin, and Reverend Manuel Scott Jr. This is going to be a major, major revival. It's the first one that we've conducted since I've been here. Each night from starting at 7 o'clock, we're just going to have a holy good time, and these are powerful speakers. It'll be important for us and our community. So we want you to tell your friends, those that are members of other churches, to come on out to Bethel on those 3 nights, the 11th through the 13th of October. If it's something we all will need, I know God's going to show up and bless. So please, note that and take careful attention that we invite others to come and be part of that. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, with that, it is now tithing time. Amen? It is tithing time. And as we go, Brother Earl.
Good morning, church. My voice is at its finest this morning, but aren't you happy to be here? Are you glad? Because God says me this morning. I got up early and I was testing my voice and everything. I know I woke my wife up, but God touched me and says, "Yo, let us go into my sanctuary and everything will be okay." And I know everything is okay, and it's given time. And you know God loves and happy giver. So at the direction of the ushers, please stand, and the direction of the ushers, please march down the aisle. with your tithes and offering.
That's right.
Thank you.
Shall we all stand?
Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, gracious Lord, we come into your presence right now. Oh, Lord, somebody needs to hear a word from you.
Advance his kingdom.
And the scripture says that Jesus said, you didn't show that Jesus would give to his disciples. The parable about the vine and the branches would be their last. Amen. So let me paint the picture. I'm a visual person, and I just want to paint a picture of the scriptures. The scripture takes place during the last days of Jesus. It's Thursday, the night before he's crucified. And prior to this, they had been in the upper room. Jesus had his last supper with the disciples. And they left the upper room and they traveled to the Mount of Olives and they end up in the Garden of Gethsemane. And we all know that in the garden is a place where Jesus was betrayed and it was a place where he agonized about dying on the cross.
Yes, yes.
It is here where Jesus teaches through a metaphor about branches and a vine dresser. And as you begin to read this, you wonder, why would Jesus be teaching about grapes? Amen. So why would this lesson of this nature be the last one that he would teach to his disciples? And he also told them, in this parable, you read on to verse 16, he says, you did not choose me. I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit. See, Jesus was teaching them that they would have to depend on him for everything. Amen. And when they were in the garden, Jesus gives them this very important lesson that they would have to carry them even after he was gone. And he first addresses them. He says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. He was making his deity known. Trail down and grow around the ground. They don't there. But when the branches grow along the ground, their leaves get coated with dust. And when the rain comes, the branches become sick and lifeless. That's what a vine dresser in a vineyard would probably tell me. And the vine dresser in the vineyard, he would take a bucket of water looking for branches and tie them to a trellis. And pretty soon, the branches produce fruit again. See, God, see the God we serve. The God we serve is much like the vine dresser in the vineyard. We serve a merciful God. See, during our period of time when we are not producing fruit, he picks us up so that we can start producing more fruit. He picks us up when we are sunk so low, even when we're so deep in places we can't even lift ourselves out, even if we try, he washes us clean and gives us another chance to bear fruit for his glory until we get it right. It took me a long time to see that. No, he just doesn't cut you off. He's not that kind of a God. Then he talks about the branches that bear fruit. Then he says, in every branch that bear fruit, he prunes so that the branch can bear more fruit.
Right, right.
How weird is that? Says the unfruitful branches he lifts up, but the fruitful branches he cuts back.
Right.
You know, to a vine dresser, this is the pruning process. He removes all the growth that is dead or dying to make sure sunlight can get to all the fruit, bearing branches to increase the size and the quality of the fruit, to encourage new fruit development. That's the task of the vine dresser in the vineyard. For us, the pruning process is the most difficult and painful for us. This is where character is developed. You know, here you are going about your life and thinking you're doing the things that you should be doing, and there comes God. He will move in and cut some stuff out of your life that's holding you back in there. It could be something that you're trying to hold on to, but he's just got to cut it away. It could be a person, it could be a place, or it could be a thing, amen. Sometimes he has to cut back things in our lives for us to produce more fruit for him. See, the vine dresser does the cutting, and he knows what's best for us. Sometimes we wonder, what is God doing in our lives by taking away this and by not allowing that? Amen. You wonder, Lord, what are you doing with my life? Amen. No, he's not trying to get you. He's just trying to get you to the point where you produce good fruit. Amen. This is the tough part for Christians to understand. Remember, he called us for his purpose. Things that are gone, that are not aligned up to his purpose, he will simply take it away, amen, whether we like it or not. See, God wants us to be productive for things that support his kingdom, amen. So that means we may not get jobs we want. We may not live in places where we want. God has a way of knowing things that we don't even know for his purpose, amen. So if we just stick back and trust the true mind, not about us. Through this passage of scripture, the word abide is used a whole lot of times. The word abide means to stay. It means to dwell. It means to remain. It means to continue. It means to tarry. It means to endure. We have to learn to abide with the Lord. The word abide has everything to do with our spiritual survival. Jesus says, I am the vine and said, without the Lord, you could lose your mind. Stay connected with the Lord. She would tell us that when we were little bitty kids. Stay connected to the Lord. See, in the vineyard, the abiding process takes place when the vine meets the branch. Amen. That's in the vineyard. That's where the abiding process takes place. It's done through a process called photosynthesis. It's when the leaves on the branch convert the sunlight into nutrients. And as a result, more leaves grow and fruit is produced from the branches. But if the branches are not solidly connected to the vine, the sap cannot flow freely to nourish the plant, and as a result, no fruit is produced. See, plants get its nutrients from the sun. We get our spiritual nutrients that come from the Lord. Amen. Make no mistake about it. You can only be nourished spiritually from Jesus, from the Lord. Amen. The scripture says, from him we live and move and have our being. Amen. It is Jesus that gives us life. It is him who gives us hope. It is him who gives us power. And if we don't want to lose your, if you don't want to lose your spiritual strength, then keep abiding with the Lord and stay connected to the vine. Amen. Stay connected. So here's how you stay connected. You stay connected by praying to the Lord.
Come to Jesus.
lifted up their prayers and petitions. Those that sat quietly in their pews and had a word for you. We've been reminded, dear God, to stay connected to you. So however you do it, dear God, we ask that you just stay connected with our spirit, that you would just use us and mold us and grow us and strengthen us. Those that need encouragement, dear God, encourage them. Those that need healing, heal them. Those that just want to praise you and bless you because you've been so good, receive our prayers and our praise. We ask this now, God, in the mighty, matchless, and wonderful name of Jesus. Let the church say,
amen.
Let's give God praise once again for the worship. Now remember that there's a bribe offering this afternoon. Come about 2:30. There's a wonderful meal that's going to be prepared so that we might break bread together. And then a great service this afternoon, calling all men and drive to the chapel. That's what we're asking men to do. And you come back and bring the bread time.